Johan Sanders es quien nos va a hablar de este tema y va a moderar Germán Divela. Presentamos a ambos. Johan Sanders es profesor emérito de la Universidad de Wageningen, en Holanda, en el área de desarrollo de biorrefinerías a pequeña escala, con baja inversión, como método de impulsar la innovación. Además, posee un PhD en biología molecular. En tanto, Germán Divela es ingeniero agrónomo, socio de la empresa Bio4 y Bioeléctrica, es directivo en FADA, la Fundación Agropecuaria para el Desarrollo Argentino, e integra el Comité Ejecutivo de APRESID. Vamos a dejarlos entonces en primer término con Germán Divela, quien va a hacer una introducción de esta disertación, de este panel. Adelante, por favor.
Hola. Hola, buen día. La idea de este panel está muy relacionado con lo que es hoy la misión de APRESID, que no solo somos productores de alimentos, sino además de fibras y energías. Y además de eso, de cómo buscar una solución, no solo a la situación coyuntural que está viviendo hoy el productor agropecuario, sino una mirada más a largo plazo. Estamos convencidos que como productores debemos generar fuentes de trabajo, además de alimentos, fibras y energías. Y todo este tipo de integración vertical que nos van a proponer en esta disertación, Joan, apunta también a eso. O sea, no solo seguir trasladando granos a los puertos, sino empezar a trasladar productos con mayor valor, donde el costo del flete impacte menos. Y la idea de la presentación de Joan es que busquemos los lugares donde cada uno de nosotros podemos participar. Por eso esto de refinerías en pequeña escala, pero es mucho más amplio lo que él va a presentar, para que podernos integrar, si hay que integrarse, o tal vez tomar riesgos de manera particular. Espero que les sirva. La realidad es que APRESID tiene una relación muy estrecha con la Embajada de Holanda y agradecemos haber podido traer a Joana que explique sobre las tecnologías para que podrían volcarse en la Argentina y ser un canal, tal vez, APRESID para que pueda llegar a los productores argentinos la implementación de este tipo de tecnologías.
Good. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to start by thanking the APRESID organization for inviting me so that I can share some of the results we have had in Wageningen University, but also in my former industrial business that I was in. I will show you that small scale, or in general, needing not that much capital is very important to start up a lot of things. And that might be important for Argentina, like, for instance, to start up the chemical industry from biomass raw materials, but also to process crops that contain a lot of water, and therefore the transportation is expensive, and even the processing with water of crops that are dry. And that all in addition to the great agriculture that you already have. That we use biomass for, for food, that's clear to all of you. That we also use biomass for a number of non-food applications, like paper or construction of wood or cotton. That's clear, and the challenge for the next few decades will be that we use that same biomass also to substitute fossil raw materials that nowadays we find in products like transportation fuels, electricity, heat, chemicals, materials, and so on. And we speak about a bioeconomy if, say, about 30% of all fossil raw materials will be substituted. And we speak about a bioeconomy if also in this system food and feed is included. There are several reasons why different people can be interested in a bioeconomy. And it's very good to understand at least why yourself could be interested, because if you talk to somebody else, there will be a lot of misunderstandings if you speak from different drivers. Could be shortage of cheap oil, or high energy prices, or security of energy supply, Climate change, of course, is an important one. Rural development in some countries or in some parts of countries. Developing countries, well, most of the developing countries have great amounts of biomass and they have not much access to fossil raw materials. And of course, the geopolitical conditions that we again and again see in these last few years again. If we look to some numbers, for food and feed today, we use about 5,000 million tons of biomass, dry weight biomass, per year in this world. For the non-food applications, we need about 2,000 million tons. Wood for cooking, again, it's for food actually, 4,000 million tons. And if we really would like to speak about the bioeconomy that has 30% of the expected raw materials in the year 2050, if we continue to use them in the inefficient way as we do today, we need, in addition to what I just said, about 20,000 million tons. And that's an enormous challenge. It has a good message because in Europe, where we always had the last 20, 30 years oversupply of biomass and agricultural materials, there will not be oversupply anymore. There will be much more labor for farmers, much more income. But the bad part of that message, of course, is that some people believe that even tomorrow we should be there, that we should have the 20,000 million tons. And then there might be some competition, of course, with food while we have the food or fuel discussion. I would like to show you how we can meet this challenge. And that can be done with a combination of design rules that I have indicated, well, here. Of course, we should use our fossil raw materials in a much more efficient way. We should increase field yield. And in addition to increasing the field yield, I think it's very much important to keep all components that are required for soil fertility as much as possible on the field. Don't ship it to a big factory and ship it back at the cost of a lot of capital and energy and transport. Become more efficient with biomass. Use all the different components. Nowadays, for instance, for animal feed, we have biomass in which protein is present, sometimes also energy parts for the animals. They are the valuable parts for the animal feed. But there are a number of components that have no value for animal feed. And even there are some components that are even toxic and you don't want them. And if you can separate all these components, each of these components can be valorized. Use all of these components at their highest value. And what I want to show you in the next half hour, is that structure in general, and that can be a macroscopic structure like wood. You can build something, and later, of course, you can burn it. So you have twice you have the benefit. But also molecular structure has a much, much higher value than just the caloric value of biomass. And therefore, it's much better to look into products of proteins or chemicals or materials and not so much in transportation fuels and electricity starting. And of course, there will always be components that can only be used in that way, and that side catch is very important in the economic term as well. And my last design rule is also an important one. And I said it already, reduce the capital you need for novel processes. And changing our raw material base from fossil to biomass, we will need many, many new processes. And for each process, if that will cost $50 million or $80 million or $100 million or even more, well, I've seen in my life several bosses that had shaking knees when they had to make such a decision for a process of a first time. So the lower the capital you require, the better. And when you have low capital, you also can build on a rather small scale. In Europe, If we would get with the different crops that we have here, like corn or barley or grass or whatever, you see here the main five, six crops, and there is a spread of yield in Europe. The Netherlands is an agricultural country where we have quite high yields. And if all the countries of Europe would get that high yield, then we would not only have the red part, which is the actual yield in Europe, but in addition to that, we will have the green part. And that green part, that could be used for the bioeconomy. And that is about 20% of the total amount of raw materials, fossil raw materials, of today. And in here, I even do not include the GMO technology, because that would even increase these green parts. But in Europe, we don't like that very much. Well, another very important one is to increase the efficiency of use. All of you, as I see it here in the audience, you get about 2,000 or 2,500 kilocalories digestible energy every day on the dish, on the table. And if I ask you how much energy actually is required to get that on the table, it is 20-fold. And that 20-fold, half of that comes from biomass, the other half comes from fossil. And this is the amount that we require. And if we would be able to increase the yield of food, actually, from 5% as it is today to 10%, so still we need 10 times more input than output, then we would get the amount of energy on which all cars in Europe can drive. And that's, again, another 20%. And with my goal of 30% substitution of fossil, well, it should be possible already with these two design rules. If you look to the efficiency of our food production, well, we can also see similar thing with the efficiency of our nitrogen use as a fertilizer. This is the amount of products, protein, that we get in our food, daily food. This is the vegetable part, and this is the meat part, the animal part. 1 million tons of nitrogen, 2 million tons of nitrogen. And the input on the other side is about 20 million tons, which is an enormous loss of all kinds of nitrogen components, either to the soil or to the atmosphere, some with even very bad adverse greenhouse gas effects. So we should be much more efficient with our protein sources as well. Well, here you see something which didn't go well with the translation. The picture is disturbed. But you should have seen a triangle here, where in the top part are the high-value products, like pharmaceutical products. And I say, well, we don't get a lot of return from that in the sense of climate change or if substituting fossil raw materials. And on the bottom part of this triangle that you should have been able to see, there is a large volume, but the value is very low. And that's electricity and heat and so on. But in the middle part, there is a category which has quite a high volume and at the same time quite a high value. And the products that you can find in this category are proteins for animal feed. They are chemicals and materials. And my message is that once we do the biorefining, some of the components, if we can convert them to these products, at least we get some economic carrier, because without a good business case, it will not happen. All the other components, well, if it's not feasible to put them into high value, well, then the side catch is to make electricity and transportation fuels from it. Translation is not well. In reality, in the Netherlands, the triangle is indicated like here. Here you see the volume of the products, and here are indicated the value. This is energy, this is animal feed, and you see that some products can be quite high value, but the volume is quite small. And these are the raw materials, these are the actual fossil raw materials, and these are the agro raw materials that we now use. Biorefining is, in a way, the best thing we can do to be efficient with biomass and also for economic conditions. But as you can see here, the different types of categories... Sorry, it doesn't work in my hands. For instance, let's take the food business. There are many players in the food business, and although they are serving different sites in the value chain, well, they know their language and they talk to each other. But if you want to collaborate with the food and, for instance, the electricity companies, they talk a totally different language, and it is very difficult to get them together and have similar goals, which is required to have the optimal output of the biomass. If you want to substitute fossil raw materials, it's very good to look at the economics, the actual economics of these fossil products. And here you see the four main categories. It is heat, that is electricity, transportation fuels, and chemicals. And I expressed the cost in euros per energy content, because kilograms is very difficult for the first two. And you see that heat is quite cheap, because you can use coal, and in addition, the capital, the orange part, is not that high. For making electricity, you need twice as much input as output, but still coal, and you need quite a lot of capital. For transportation fuel, you have to use oil, which is more expensive. The yield is quite good, and the capital is modest. But for the average bulk chemical that is produced in the world, we need about three times as much input in energy terms as output in product term, in chemical product term. And in addition, we need a lot of capital to start from oil, convert that into naphtha, into other products again and again. You need a factory and another factory and so on. And if you realize that some components from biomass that you can isolate by biorefining have already almost the chemical structure that in the petrochemical industry is obtained with those many steps, and in case of the biorefinery, you can do that in one step or in two steps in a much milder conditions. And that is very important. And if you would burn that same biomass into electricity or transportation fuel, you would destroy more than 90% of the value that is given from those plants. This is the same bar for the chemical industry, so you see quite a lot of raw material cost and a lot of capital cost. And what we figured out is that the amount of capital cost is very much related to the amount of heat that is dissipated from the process over the whole value chain of that chemical product. So there are some that have quite modest capital cost, and they, because they only have modest dissipation and loss of heat, but others that have very high capital cost, and the average is what you see here. So if we could reduce the capital cost, or in other words, if we can reduce the need for capital cost because of heat exchange, well, we can be in business. And in the petrochemical industry, where they always start with oil, well, they cannot circumvent that. They have to do that. And since there are not many new chemicals in the past 20 years, actually the only way to compete with one another is build a bigger factory and another bigger factory, because when you have already a lot of capital in your product production cost, you can benefit just from economy of scale. But reducing the capital cost per ton will offer that there will be more economic room for the biomass, for agricultural products, and in addition, of course, for labor, because labor is part of the agricultural cost. And there will be more opportunities to operate on a much smaller scale, even for bulk chemicals. And I will show you some examples. And you will also be much less dependent on the infrastructure of large chemical sites, like in Europe, in Rotterdam, where you have 40 kilometers on only chemical factories, or in Leverkusen, or in Houston, or in Singapore, or Shanghai. They are all very big sites. But you could have a factory in the middle of Argentina without chemical past and still produce chemicals. This slide shows that you need a lot more labor to make the raw materials, but that it will be paid by the reduction of cost in the capital. And that makes me to make this remark. Using biomass in the chemical industry, well, on large scale, is not essential for competitive advantage anymore. Using biomass in the chemical industry can create many jobs. For the steam engine, the economy of scale is very essential, because steam engine is heat exchange. And the steam engine made many jobs redundant. And I dare to say that Mr. Karl Marx should better have fought or got rid of the steam engine to get the jobs saved that he wants than to make the British bourgeoisie as its problem. This is an example, real-life example. The chemical is called epichlorohydrine. This is the chemical formula. Today, from propylene and from chlorine, there's this reaction. And chlorine contains a lot of energy. It gets the energy from electricity, and electricity gets it from coal. And all the energy that is in the chlorine will dissipate during this reaction and require a lot of capital, and not cheap capital, because chlorine is very corrosive. You have expensive capital. If you start with glycerol, which actually is a side product of the biodiesel industry, each of the three carbons that you have here as well, but here as well, has already a group, an alcohol group in this case, and it's quite easy to convert this into the intermediate and into the same end product. And while this product costs about 1,500 euros per ton on the world market, and if glycerol will cost, well, say 300, 400 euros, there will be a very big margin, maybe of 40, 50% of this, which is unique in the chemical industry. In my group in Wageningen, we worked on amino acids, because there are 20 different amino acids, and each amino acid has already functionalities, the chemical groups that you can see here. And we were able to produce at least these four different chemicals. And I will show you the nice chemical formula from this reaction. Not that tonight I can have an exam with you, but more important is that you see the difference in complexity. This is the new process that we have designed. Glutamic acid, with one enzymatic step, we come to this intermediate, and here is the end product, the solvent. And we can also get that in the conventional petrochemical route. We start with natural gas, and in 8 steps, we come to this same product. And 8 steps means 8 times equipment, means 8 times that you have losses in your process, and it makes it much more complicated, it makes it much less efficient in raw materials, and of course, you need a lot of capital, which you don't need in this case. This shows a big ethanol factory as we have in Rotterdam. It produces about 400 kilotons of alcohol with a market value of 200 million euros. And it has a side product called DDGS, dried distillers grain and soluble, that is sold to the animal feed industry. The value of that is less than 50 million euros. 10% of this DDGS, which in quantity is about the same as the main product, as you can see, is the glutamic acid. And that glutamic acid, if we convert that to the solvent that I just showed you, just the 10% of this side product has already a value which is higher than the 100%. And since this DDGS contains also a lot of adverse components for animal feed, like, for instance, toxic components like potassium and phosphate that you don't like in animal feed, certainly not in the overcrowded areas in, as in the Netherlands, then once you have it in your factory, you can improve it, and I will show you some other example later today. A totally different way of substituting fossil raw materials is not exactly make the same chemical, but make something which is in function very similar. Here, some of you might recognize polystyrene. Well, this is not polystyrene. This is polylactic acid. It's produced from sugar, fermented to lactic acid, and polymerized. And then it has undergone very similar process as polystyrene. And then you can make something like this, which is used to isolate food in the Netherlands, or you can use it to isolate houses when it is minus 30 or minus 30, 40 in, well, Alaska or whatever the previous speaker said. And that is being produced by a Dutch company now, and it works quite well. Well, this is a complicated sheet as well, but I don't go into the detail. I only want to show you the map of Rotterdam here. Actually, the chemical site of Rotterdam. Here is 140 million tons of oil that enters every year into the Netherlands. And after refining and separating, we get, for instance, petrol or diesel or whatever, but another fraction is naphtha, and from naphtha, all chemicals are produced in the world. And in one step, you can produce ethylene, for instance, or propylene or xylene. In two steps, you can make more oxidized, etc., etc. And each of these blocks is one factory. A factory that costs 200 million euros or 500 million euros or 1 billion euros or whatever. And the color, which is explained here, the more yellow, it's the more Shell, but there are also other companies in Rotterdam. But the message that I want to put over here is that you start from materials that have a high energy content, and down the ladder here, you go into direction of molecules that have a lower energy content. And if you want to use biomass to substitute fossil raw materials, the message is that the best is to circumvent the need for capital cost for heat exchange, is start from a biomass molecule, for instance, sugar, if you want to make something which is on this line. If you want to make something in this line, it's better to use citric acid. If you want to make something higher up here, it is better to use an oil, for instance. And if you do that, very little capital is required for heat exchange. You can spend more cost in raw materials, in agricultural raw materials, which includes labor. And of course, that could be beneficial to climate, to people, and also to planet. Well, this shows that if you do that scheme, you also need a lot less raw materials as compared in this case, or in this case, and in this strategy. First, people start with the production of ethylene, like they do in Brazil at this moment, start from sugar, go to ethanol and then to ethylene, well, then you don't benefit from the advantage that I just said, because first you have to go uphill, need a lot of capital, heat exchange, and then you go downhill again. And that's not the way to do. And that's also reflected in this case. This would be the better strategy as compared to what I just said. Well, lots of people believe in second generation ethanol. And I would say in not all cases that can happen. It can happen in the Midwest in the United States because they have a lot of waste material from their corn. It might even happen in Argentina from the leftover stems from the soy, or at least the easy digestible part of those stems that now go very rapidly into the atmosphere in 3, 4, 5 months. But the collection problem is quite major, and if you want to do that in Europe, I don't see many locations where you can do that. Convert straw into something which is called pre-treated at the cost of a lot of money, and then another enzymatic treatment gives it here. Then you can make alcohol, but alcohol is a transportation fuel with not much value. It were much better if you would make a product with a higher value, a chemical, for instance. If you look to all agricultural materials or all agricultural residues, you can group them into 5 different groups because I rank them in the order of their content in protein. This one has 0%, which is wheat straw that I just showed you. And I would say don't touch it because you have to spend capital, a lot of energy, you do a pre-treatment and you get something which doesn't have a high value. With soy on the other side, soy meal I should say, it has already 50% protein, which is quite high value, and it's very difficult to increase the value. If you start with soy meal of say 40%, well, it might be another story, then it comes quite close to my example here, where we have rape meal, which has 35%, which is just good enough in Europe to feed pigs, or the category of 15%, which is just good enough to feed cattle, and the 5% group, well, it's more or less very low value and too costly to collect it and do the transport, actually. But the message here is first take out the protein, get already a lot of value, and then see what you can do with all the other components. We were challenged by an electricity company in the Netherlands, and they said electricity is nowadays produced from coal, and coal costs 45 euros per ton biomass equivalents. That's actually this dotted line. And if we look to wood that we can import from Canada, well, it is double the price. Straw on the field is cheap, but collected it's more expensive. And if you wash away the elements that you don't like, well, the cost is higher. So we said, why not use rape meal? And again, something is wrong with this, with the translation of this one. Rape meal, do the biorefining, as you can see here, and you add even more cost. But if you split them, you see why. This is, for instance, protein. And that protein, per kilogram of protein, has a much higher value as protein than in this raw material. Because in this raw material, there are other components, like I said, potassium or phosphate or toxic components. And this is pure protein, so it has a much higher value. And the other components, for instance, the cellulose and the hemicellulose, can be converted into lactic acid. Could be used to make polylactic acid, could also be used to substitute fossil raw material, sorry, to substitute starch in animal feed lot. In addition, you also get amino acids that you can use to make chemicals or that you can use for animal feed. In addition, you get your potassium and your phosphate in separate streams. So you can recycle your minerals to the agricultural field. And of course, you get some leftover lignin that can be burned into electricity, and this is at the cost of coal. And here, this is an example, actually, of a dry raw material that, in order to be processed, you need to add water. And you can afford that because all the different products that you can get from it will give more income than the cost. And you can recycle your minerals because this process is reasonably small. I should go to the next one. Here you can see that in this case, the process that I showed you is 40,000 tons. So that would be equivalent to 15,000 to 20,000 hectares of soy or same of rapeseed or sunflower seed. The cost of investment is only 20 million euros. And the economic numbers are certainly not worse, even better, than, for instance, the second-generation ethanol factory that was started last year in the United States, but they require 300 million euros to start up the unit. And in Rotterdam, there's a biodiesel factory on oil, on vegetable oil, and that costed almost 800 million euros to start it up because of economy of scale is required. Another source of biomass is sugar. And I think that could be a very attractive sugar also here in Argentina. In the Netherlands, we just had a study from Deloitte, and they indicated that in the Northwest Europe, like the Netherlands, because of very good agricultural conditions, the cost of sugar should not be higher than the cost of sugar in the two main sugar companies, countries, Brazil and Thailand. And sugar can be used for fermentation processes. And what we did is, again, with the principles of heat exchange, or actually preventing heat exchange, is not using traditional fermentation, where they often use a lot of oxygen, aerate the fermenter, but do it under anaerobic conditions, because if you do that, the energy content of your end product is almost the same as the energy content of your starting material, and that means not much heat exchange has to be done. That means low capital cost, and it means a very high yield on your raw materials. And we are now running 5 projects, sometimes 100% paid by companies, by the industry, to do this. There are, of course, some good examples from the past, from nature, and we are mimicking nature. Ethanol production is an anaerobic process, has a very high yield on energy, at least. Lactate production has a very high yield, anaerobic again. Acetone, butanol, a very old process, but still, it has a very high yield on energy. But aerobic processes, like amino acids, glutamic acid, well, quite a low yield, and itaconic also, while here, 30 years, 40 years of research and development has gone in. This looks complicated, but this here you see 40 different bulk chemicals. And in this line, you see the capital cost of these raw materials, and here you see the variable cost, the raw materials. And this diagonal, actually, it's the sum of this and this, determines the total overall cost price of the chemical. And if you would make chemicals in an aerobic way from sugar, as I indicated, then we would have this line. And you see that only a few bulk chemicals nowadays produced from petroleum are more expensive than this red line. And all these that are cheaper, well, we have no chance, no economic chance at least. And even if we would do it from lignocellulose, well, it will be the other red line, which is a little bit more expensive. If we would choose for the anaerobic process, then the cost prices will be about here, about 500, 600, 700 euros, depending on how much cost are required to purify the protein, not to make it by fermentation. And here you see that, well, a great number of today's bulk chemicals can be produced from sugar. And that can also be done in Argentina, starting from sugar cane or whatever, or beet even. If you look here, I made a few years ago a scheme for Brazil. I hope it is readable. But here you see 24 million hectares of soy, say 400 kilometers by 600 kilometers. And you get some products, of course. You get protein, you get oil, you get even, you can make biodiesel from it. And the numbers are indicated here. And of course, you get income. But my message would be, if only one quarter of the soy land would be used for grass and do a biorefining of grass, that you can see here in this quarter, well, the amount of products that you can get for animal feed, for making oil, for making all kinds of other products in the bio-based economy, it will increase. And if you, in addition to that, another quarter would put into sugarcane, well, you can make the chemicals that I just said and increase the amount of income by a factor of 4 on that same area. And of course, your soil fertility will increase because you have a rotation. And well, it may be not be done in this way as I designed it for Brazil, but there are many ways to do it. Here you might recognize a potato. I worked for a potato starch industry, and very bad for our competitive edge was that we had to compete with starch that is produced from corn or from wheat. And you see the difference here. While the starch amount is the same, more or less per hectare, and the side products are also the same, more or less per hectare, the amount of water in the potato is about 20 times more than in the case of corn. And that gives us serious problems in the potato starch industry. We cannot process during the whole year because the potatoes cannot be stored over the whole year. And the transportation costs are much higher because, well, 5 times much more water than dry weight. But if you use genetic modification, for instance, to increase the amount of lysine, another amino acid that is highly desired in animal feed, then, well, you benefit from all this water because you can accumulate that lysine to a certain concentration. Well, and the concentration here is the same as the concentration in the water in corn. But that means that the absolute amount per hectare will be much higher. And here you see some of the economics. While this is the dry weight of the total crops, you see the amount of lysine. In corn, it's about 27 kilograms per hectare. But in potato, this was done by Monsanto in corn a few years ago. And in potato, it's about 700 kilograms. Work that has been done in Wageningen. And the value, of course, of the starch is here, but you get a lot higher increase because of the lysine. And very quite recently, my colleagues in Wageningen were successful in not only producing lysine, but for instance also itaconic acid, which is such a chemical that can substitute fossil raw materials. Well, here you see a slide that's also not 100% well translated. But the cost price by fermentation, by aerobic fermentation, nowadays of lysine, for instance, is at this height. And the amount of energy that you require is about this. And I showed you three different ways, three alternatives that have more or less half of the economic costs in producing them, and also half of the amount of energy that is required. And that is the anaerobic fermentation, that is the synthesis by plants, and that is the biorefining as lysine as one of the components that you can use for making proteins and so on. The last part of my presentation will be devoted on small-scale biorefineries in the agricultural domain. And in the Netherlands, to show you a typical value chain, sugar beet, they are harvested, collected at the site of the field. The farmer, then they are transported by lorry to a big factory that makes crystalline sugar. It also makes molasses that contains a lot of sugar. And that was the reason why my former fermentation company likes that very much, because we wanted to make baker's yeast. And all the minerals of about 50,000 hectares that were concentrated in this molasses, well, we were allowed to put that in the North Sea until the late 70s. Then our government said, now you have to build a wastewater treatment. We did. And that wastewater treatment was very good in operation for the organic compounds, but not for the potassium. And we had to concentrate it, so we had to buy an evaporator, a lot of capital, a lot of energy, and then the logistics to bring back 50,000 hectare equivalents of potassium back to the fields. And that is quite a logistic effort. If you can do a biorefining quite close to the fields and recycle, say, 70% of the water, including most of the minerals, then transportation cost will be much less, because you don't need to transport five times as much water as compared to the sugar. You don't need a lot of energy and capital here. And if you are smart and are able to make an intermediate product here that you can store over the whole year with easy technology, then in a centralized factory, you can do the more difficult part. And this factory could be in operation 12 months a year, while this factory is only operation for 4 months a year. So the capital cost over this whole new chain, small-scale chain, will be a lot less. And you don't need to do a concentration of the potassium, as I said, to ship it back to the 50,000 hectares, because if this is only 500 hectares, well, in an unconcentrated way, it is 1 kilometer to the right and 1 kilometer to the left, and the farmer can do it himself. You don't need to concentrate it. This is the equipment, a laboratory scale, that we developed to make crystalline sugar from crude beet juice. We don't do carbonatation purifications before. We immediately go for a novel crystallization technology that we believe can be operated at 500 hectares per year under commercial conditions. This is a small-scale mobile factory that can process cassava roots into crude cassava starch. It was designed in my group about 12 years ago. Here you see the sea container, and here you look inside the sea container into the process. Nowadays, there are 12 or 15 of these factories in operation in Africa. And for cassava, I would say on small scale, there are certain advantages. One advantage, of course, is that if you bring the roots to the factory to be processed, they cannot be stored for more than 24 hours, because then you don't get high quality starch anymore. So the farmer has not much negotiation power, and he gets very, very low prices. But if you bring the factory to the farmer, well, then he can decide when to process, to whom he wants to sell the raw materials, and so on. And small scale has a lot more advantages, because the minerals can be recycled much easier, but there will also be a lot more care to do things on the field that cannot be mechanized. Well, I will skip this because of time. Then we go into grass biorefining. In the Netherlands, grass costs about 60 euros per ton dry weight. And here you see the different components of that dry weight. And if you were able to separate each of these components, the value would easily be 700 euros. So there's an enormous potential of added value. Of course, you need to invest in a process, and there's labor cost and energy cost, and so on. But for the moment, we have a mobile process, again in sea containers, that can produce three products. A product for pig feed, chicken feed, a product that contains fiber and some protein for cattle feed, and a juice that can also be used to make all kinds of valuable products, but also for animal feed. And if I look to the economics at that small scale, because again, we serve about 500 hectares, and of course you can serve more hectares by copying that machine manifold, grass costs about 60 euros per ton. The process costs are about 120 euros per ton. So in, because the protein is about 20% of the dry weight, if that is isolated, it will have a value because of similar quality as soy meal of about 120 euros per ton of original grass. That is not enough to cover the cost of the raw material and the process. But the other 80%, which contains the fibers and the juice components, they didn't have much value in the past because we had an oversupply of raw materials, in Europe at least. But nowadays we get more shortage, and these side products, well, they give you some income. And the total income is higher than the cost. And we hope to introduce this year a commercial factory on grass biorefining on that small scale. Once we get more and more experience in that, we could decide to go to more complicated biorefining, and not to a three products, but to an eight products biorefining of grass. And then you see that the cost will be higher, but of course also the income and the margin will be higher. So you have a gradual development if you start now. This is a drawing of a factory, a very small factory that we are now building for Uganda. It will be shipped to Uganda within 2 months from now. And this processes grass in Uganda, even at the size of 20 hectares, which is ridiculously small. But it can be done, and for Uganda there is no other possibility. They don't have agricultural land of 100 hectares or 1,000 hectares or more and more. So it's a good start, and once it works, it can give them, not only for animal feed, but also for human food, the proteins that they require. The last example is on corn. In Europe, some countries, corn is used, the whole plant, for making biogas. And biogas is used to make electricity. Very low value of using the biomass. If you separate the stems from the corn, grain, then the grain can be a good source for making corn oil or protein, but also ethanol. And in this case, we go to 60% ethanol, because that is advantageous on small scale. This again is 500 hectares, because all the waste that we cannot turn into these products goes to biogas. The waste heat from the central heat and power plant can be used to do the distillation, and you need only a very simple distillation if you go to 60% of ethanol. That can be stored because it doesn't contain a lot of water. And here, again, well, we have a cost price and a capital cost that is not higher than the very big ethanol factories in the United States that are 200 times operating at larger volumes. Here you see a pilot plant, the distillation column, the grains before storage, after storage, the stems that still go to the biogas, and here is the ethanol production and the separation. And I don't want to say and give you the message that you only have to focus on high-value products, because the low-value is also very important, because just because of the existing biogas plant and the existing way to produce electricity enables the development of the higher products. And first you have to do this step, and then you can do this step. The same as starting with grass, with three products, and then do further complicated biorefinery to eight steps. Well, in order to conclude, biorefining for feed materials and chemicals will create good income for agriculture and enable even to compete with coal, natural gas, and oil. Small-scale processing reduces capital as well as cost for energy and transportation. And they will also lead to a higher employment. Biorefining, a drawback is that it will not be easy to do, because you have to collaborate, and we are starting now the learning curve. Thank you for your attention.
Le agradecemos a Johan Sander por su disertación. Estamos ya con unos minutos pasados de tiempo, pero vamos a tratar de hacer alguna pregunta que Germán Divela va a moderar.
Hola, ¿se escucha? Sí. No, yo voy a arrancar haciéndole una consulta de si tienen medido cuál es la escala mínima de este tipo de plantas, si están pensando en asociación de productores o productores individuales, y cuál es la cantidad de, en cuánto se duplica el pago de impuestos cuando uno empieza a verticalizar en la producción. No sé si se entiende la pregunta.
The first part I certainly understand, and I will go into the second part. In general, well, you can build the sizes as you like. And for the Netherlands or for Europe, it would be good that several farmers would cooperate, because 500 hectares is even quite big for a normal farmer in the Netherlands or in Europe. If you have 10 farmers, you easily can do it. Other point is the cooperation not only with the agricultural farmers that have the land, but together with the farmers that have the animals. As it was before, that we had mixed farms, now we have specialized farms, but they have to cooperate, and then you can benefit from both. On the taxes, probably that is a very Argentinian problem that you are asking. Well, I would say as long as you don't export, but I don't understand everything of the Argentinian system, but if you would produce products that have a higher value than just the agricultural products, and that could be to make beef or pork or eggs or whatever, agricultural products again, but it might also be the chemicals that I showed you. And chemicals could be produced on scales of, say, 10,000 tons per hectare at investment costs of, say, 20,000, 40,000 million euros, which is not enormous. Of course, when you build that a little bit bigger, still it will be overseeable. And then you have products with a with low cost of transportation, with high value, and as long as you substitute products that you nowadays import from outside Argentina, I would say you will not have a lot of problems with your tax, but I don't know how fast tax evolution goes. Does that answer your question?
Sí. No sé si hay preguntas, no veo. ¿Los chicos tienen? Ah, no la veía, perdón. ¿Cómo sugiere que nos organicemos en Argentina los productores agrícolas para crear una plataforma tecnológica que asista a los emprendimientos de pequeñas biorrefinerías?
Yeah. Well, I think start with some crops, and that could be a crop like grass, which is also here abundantly available. I came by car from Buenos Aires to Rosario, and I saw a lot of grass. You have a land flat as the Netherlands almost. Some are quite wet, perfect for grass. You can start with a three products biorefining. You can do that on 500 hectares. So even a single farmer in Argentina, because they are somewhat bigger than in Europe, could start. What are the costs of investment? Well, if you want to do 500 hectares, will be about 1 million euro on equipment in the containers that I just showed you, and you make the three products. If you build that a little bit bigger, if you go, say, to 2,000 hectares or 4,000 or 5,000 hectares, well, then a combination of farmers, I would suggest, then the cost will go down because of economy of scale. So you pay, of course, more in absolute term, but per ton of grass, it will go down, and your margin will increase quite rapid. But I think in order to have low risks to start, to get acquainted to the technology, if you can start on a small scale, and even that small scale is commercial, well, that has a very low low risk. And then you can decide to build it bigger or to combine it with other things. And of course, the products that you get from that grass biorefinery are proteins for pigs. If you don't need to dry it, you save costs, but then the pigs should be in the neighborhood, otherwise the protein will decay. For cattle, very similar story. You could ensile the fibers, so you could store it over the whole year, actually. But if cattle eat it immediately, you have less cost, and that's another way to gradually step forward. But I believe that when we are starting up a grass unit in Uganda at the end of this year, it should be possible everywhere in the world.
Bueno, la última pregunta, pues estamos pasados de tiempo, pero dice, ¿los ejemplos mostrados existen solo a nivel de prueba o existen comercialmente?
Yeah. At the moment, they all are in the laboratory phase or in the pilot phase. Most are in the pilot phase. The grass unit is, as I said, at the edge of commercialization. Next year, it will be commercial. I showed you some examples of chemicals. I showed you of our own developments that are still in the laboratory phase. But I showed you also, for instance, epichlorohydrin, that is done by a Belgian company, Solvay, that has built already its third factory. And I believe they have plans to build the number four in Argentina because there is a lot of glycerol available. Well, such a process can be done for a number of other chemicals as well. DuPont Chemicals in the United States has a factory that converts starch, corn starch, into propane diol. Propane diol is a bulk chemical that is used to make polyesters. And I can show you some other examples at a commercial scale, not for 1 year, but already with a history of 5 years, some of which, as the Solvay example, that has already its third factory. And again, once you want to start, well, you should group people that have the knowledge, you should group people that have the agricultural land, you should group people that have the entrepreneurial spirits, and you should invest some money and go step by step, and then you can grow your own raw material base or your own chemical industry here, or you can own all kinds of other materials, plastics, etc., or you can export proteins at a higher value than you do now, or use them yourself to make nice animal products.
Bueno, agradecemos mucho a Joan la participación y haber venido hasta Presid. Muchas gracias.
Con este aplauso entonces despedimos a Johan Sanders y a Germán Di Vela. Damos por finalizada esta actividad y por supuesto